sorry for the technological delay here, but we're all set to begin on the 17th annual History of Astronomy Colloquium, which has been a regular occurrence sometime or another during the academic year. When it got started, we had no idea that we were starting something that was going to continue with such regularity without missing a single year since 98-99. And so we're very happy to have an occasion to hear something about the history of astronomy this afternoon. Our speaker, Barbara Becker, is now the world's leading authority on William Huggins, the man that she's going to talk about tonight. She recently won the Osterbrook Prize of the Historical Astronomy Division of the AAS for this book, which is the story of the Huggins, William Huggins and his wife, Margaret. But that wasn't where she stopped. These two volumes are a fantastic set of the correspondence, not only of William Huggins, but of his contemporaries who were mentioning him and so on. So it's quite a gold mine and a heroic effort to get this put together. So I'm very happy to be able to show it to you.
You can find it on Amazon. You just can't afford it.
I think it's only $500. So after teaching introductory courses in astronomy with some historical background, because they were for non-technical students, they were part of a general education type program, she decided she should probably go to school and learn more about the history of astronomy, and she went to Johns Hopkins, and she got involved at that time already with William Huggins. She got her PhD in the history of astronomy there. Subsequently, she went to the University of California at Irvine, where she was for 16 years, and very recently she has retired. She's down in the Chapel Hill area at the moment, so we didn't have to bring her all the way from California to be here today. But she is taking advantage of being here to do some snooping around in the Harvard archives to see about perhaps one of her next projects that's coming along. So I welcome Barbara Becker, who's going to tell us something about William Huggins' attempts to photograph the corona of the sun outside of eclipse.
Well, thank you, Owen. It's really a pleasure to be here. I love Cambridge. It's just such a treat to be able to visit the campus and to see Owen's wonderful book collection this afternoon. It was a major treat, really. The reason I only had 45 minutes this morning to spend in the archives, but the reason for my trip there may become apparent later in the talk to you. I'm basically looking for gossip, but you'll see there is a. And the reason I selected this topic is that there is a Harvard connection, which will become apparent. Now, the name of William Huggins is not something that is very familiar to modern ears, but he really was well-known in his own lifetime as a self-taught pioneer who played a key role in introducing spectrum analysis into astronomical work. Born in London in 1824, Huggins helped manage his father's silk business until the shop was sold in 1854 and the family moved to Tulse Hill, It's a well-heeled suburb, was a well-heeled suburb south of the Thames. Now it's all part of the greater London area near Brixton. These changes afforded him both the leisure time and the darkened skies necessary to pursue his growing interest in observing the heavens. He had an observatory built adjoining his home. This does not exist any longer. That area suffered severe bombing during World War II, unfortunately, so there are very few Victorian homes in that area. Right now it's a red brick box apartment complex. He was among the first to compare stellar spectra directly with those of terrestrial elements. He was the very first to observe emission lines in the spectra of nebulae, the first to view the spectrum of a nova, and the first to apply Doppler's principle to a star's light in order to determine its motion along the line of sight. All of these were recognized and applauded as major achievements in his day. His solar observations, while significant, have seldom been discussed by his biographers or historians of science. In fact, they are conspicuously missing from his own retrospective account of his life's work, an article titled The New Astronomy, which appeared in a popular magazine in 1897. Chroniclers have relied heavily on this essay for details of his life and career, with the important consequence that his solar research efforts have been all but forgotten. A case in point, Huggins's bold plan to obtain daily photographs of the solar corona, which he began developing collaboratively with his wife Margaret in 1882. His initial perception of success led him to pursue this project for many years with great zeal and conviction, and it is this effort that I wish to discuss today. In 1882, the nature of the solar corona was a mystery. A total eclipse on May 17th of that year motivated Norman Lockyer to mount a British expedition to Egypt despite growing threats of unrest in that country. Their principal objective was to observe and photograph the solar corona and its spectrum. One member of the party, Arthur Schuster, obtained many fine photographs of the corona, including a first-time photograph of the coronal spectrum. William Huggins's interest in solar observation was at a very low ebb at that time, and he and Margaret were then absorbed in trying to photograph the spectrum of the Orion Nebula. Nevertheless, their attention turned to the sun after reading a report in the London Times in which Schuster claimed that the coronal spectrum was brightest in the violet region. When plates from the Egyptian expedition were shown at the Royal Society, the Hugginses were able to see the evidence for Schuster's claim and soon set to work on a new and audacious project, photographing the solar corona without an eclipse. So you can imagine how difficult that would be. The sun, like, you could go out today and take a picture of the sun, right? But the idea that you could see in your photograph the corona, which is so faint that usually it's only visible during an eclipse, is kind of a remarkable concept. They began by creating a filter using three or four pieces of violet glass cemented together, and they placed it in front of their photographic apparatus. And with this arrangement, they photographed the sun up through the end of September of 1882. They obtained a total of 20 plates, which they believed showed coronal forms. Huggins shared these photographs with the esteemed secretary of the Royal Society, George Stokes. To help Stokes to see what Huggins believed was obvious in the photographs, he urged Stokes to kindly examine one of the photographs carefully in different lights until you were able to see the definite form. When you have seen it in one photograph, I think you will not have much difficulty to discovering exactly the same complex and peculiarly coronal form of outline in all the others. Huggins also invited photographer William Abney to assess the photographs. Abney, whose plates were used during the Egyptian eclipse, was impressed with the similarity of the Huggins' images to those that were captured during during totality in Egypt. Not only did the general features appear the same, Abney told Huggins, but also details such as rifts and streamers had the same position and form. Thus convinced that he had caught the corona in his photographic trap, William Huggins submitted a paper to the Royal Society. He and Margaret continued to photograph the sun at every possible opportunity. They wanted to obtain good images of the corona on or about May the 6th, 1883, a date on which the solar eclipse of exceptionally long duration was expected to make landfall on Caroline Island, a small coral atoll in the Pacific Ocean. And I have enlarged it because it is invisible to the naked eye at this distance from Earth. Despite the difficulty in getting there and the uncertainty of the weather, a number of observers from around the world were sent to, in eclipse parties. Among them were veteran eclipse photographers Henry Aubrey Lawrence and Charles Ray Woods. Huggins anticipated that a comparison of Lawrence's and Woods's photographs with those that he planned to take on the same day back in London would conclusively demonstrate the validity of his method, and he adapted a 7-foot Newtonian telescope specially for this purpose. While conditions were favorable for observers on Caroline Island, bad weather in London prevented taking any photographs there. Nevertheless, the Hugginses believed that they had obtained good images of the April 3rd, May 31st, and June 6th that were close enough to May 6th to justify using them as substitutes. The RAS Assistant Secretary William Wesley then converted the Hugginses' photographs into drawings for publication. Lawrence and Woods were struck by the similarities between their photographs and those Huggins had captured. Notable in all the images, in their opinion, was evidence of a rift in the corona near the sun's north pole. And although this was compelling evidence, it was hardly conclusive. Not wishing to wait until the next convenient solar eclipse, Huggins devised a new plan to test his method that involved obtaining a large number of daily images of the uneclipsed sun, which could then be analyzed for internal consistency. So instead of comparing one photograph taken on the day of an eclipse, he wanted to take a whole slew of pictures in succession and look for signs of similarities in the features. To do this efficiently required a climate less fickle than London's, some place with reliably clear skies, preferably at a high elevation. And then, if the method proved workable, Huggins claimed, the corona may be successfully photographed from day to day with a definiteness that would allow for the study of changes which are doubtless going on in it. In December 1883, he requested and received a small grant from the Royal Society to fund an expedition to Switzerland to test his method. Ray Woods, one of the photographers from the Caroline Island, and he also was there for the Egyptian eclipse, Ray Woods was selected to spend 2 or 3 months taking daily pictures of the sun atop the Riffelberg near Zermatt. And this actually is a drawing of the hotel that was just had recently been built there by a enterprising Swiss hotelier, Seiler. And so the railway did not go there yet. That would be a little a year or two after this occurred. But this is the Riffel House, which some of it still stands. It actually suffered in a major fire just a decade or two ago and has since been somewhat rebuilt. Woods trained with Huggins and Abney to master recent improvements in Huggins's photographic technique. Instead of filtering the sunlight with violet glass, Huggins now planned to rely on selective sensitivity in the photographic plates themselves to capture light only from the desired narrow region of the solar spectrum. Dublin's renowned instrument maker Howard Grubb was commissioned to build an apparatus, which he later called a coronagraph. That was the first use of that term, based on Huggins's design. Woods arrived on the Riffel along, he was a photographer, he had to carry chemicals, started snowing. Unfortunately, this was not an auspicious time to be testing such a delicate and exacting photographic method. The advantage of clear skies found at such an elevation culminated in the catastrophic explosion of Mount Krakatoa, on August the 27th. The so-called Krakatoites of the day rightfully blamed airborne volcanic particles for the unusually colorful sunsets and other atmospheric effects that were observed. And here's where the Harvard connection comes in. But Huggins had been perturbed by a letter critical of his method published recently in the American journal Science. The letter was written by American astronomer and photography expert William Henry Pickering. Not yet 30 years old, Pickering was teaching at MIT and assisting in the photographic research projects of his older brother, Edward, director of the Harvard College Observatory. Young Pickering's letter detailed his attempts to duplicate Huggins's coronal photographs. Very corona-like effects were certainly produced, Pickering admitted, but unfortunately no two of the pictures were alike. He concluded that though it is very easy to obtain a corona-like image, one may readily be deceived in such matters. The situation was a bit complicated, however, by the fact that Huggins had recently criticized Edward Pickering for what, in Huggins's view, were wildly wrong measures for the spectral lines in Alpha Lyrae. He privately urged Pickering to re-examine his data because it would be better that you should yourself discover the error and publish the correction than that the matter should be pointed out by others. Now, in this excerpt from a letter to Edward Holden, and you can see why I'm interested in looking in the archives to see what kind of correspondence Holden had with Pickering. This is a letter from Huggins to Holden, and I think Holden was then at the Washburn University, and I think that Washburn Observatory in Madison, and I think Huggins must have assumed, well, the United States is really big, they probably don't talk to one another. Well, I don't know whether they did or not, but here we see Huggins' unfiltered views of what he really meant to say to Pickering, but was too polite to say. Well, his frank words to Pickering, nonetheless, were alarming to one individual in particular, and that was Anna Palmer Draper. She felt that Huggins' ungentlemanly comments to Pickering had no place in proper scientific discourse. And Huggins later came to suspect that his criticism of Edward Pickering's work contributed to his brother William's desire to return the favor. Huggins was incensed by the younger Pickering's insinuation that he was lacking in rudimentary methodological and interpretive skills, and he drafted a reply that was both caustic and personal. This appeared in Science as well. There were several exchanges that followed these. His anger only intensified when Pickering's critical letter was published again, this time in Photographic News, which, unlike Science, was a British journal that his colleagues had ready access to. Few Londoners were reading Science magazine, and so would have probably never even known about the criticism. But Photographic News, they knew. Huggins did not want to be distracted by a dispute with Pickering or anyone else at that time. He had to prepare his worthy address. Nevertheless, he could not lose sight of the fact that delicate new methods, such as the one he was proposing, would always draw fire, and he worried that Pickering's public criticism would embolden others to raise similar questions in the wake of his forthcoming address. Furthermore, he was growing increasingly troubled by his sense of obligation to say something in his lecture about the Riffel photographs. After all, they had been obtained thanks to the Royal Society's generosity, and they comprised the bulk of evidence to date for the efficacy of his method. But he had begun to harbor personal doubts about these images, doubts that he could only hint at obliquely in letters to Stokes, but he did not dare discuss even in confidence with anyone. He pressed Gill for any positive evidence that would assuage his worries. But neither Gill nor Woods could do anything until they received Grubb's new coronagraph. And unfortunately, a variety of shipping misadventures had delayed the instrument's arrival from Dublin. In fact, it wasn't even received until nearly 2 weeks after Huggins delivered his address. So, unable to present any new evidence in his Baconian lecture, Huggins delivered just a more elaborate and sophisticated version of his Royal Institution talk. He carefully laid out the theoretical foundation for his method of photographing the uneclipsed sun, and with Pickering's criticisms fresh in his mind, he enumerated the many precautions he had taken to prevent the appearance of false effects. He emphasized the persuasive value of the sheer numbers of his successful plates, and he expanded on the electrical theory of the solar corona. In the event, the lecture was very well received. But afterwards, as Huggins prepared its text for publication, he impatiently awaited some confirmatory news from Gill at the Cape. His lengthy correspondence with Gill during this period is an extraordinary record. Gill kept Huggins's incoming letters, along with book press copies of his own outgoing letters, some barely legible, as you can see from this example. The press book copies are, if you want to see examples, there are some in the Pickering collection. This is a pre-carbon paper method of keeping an outgoing letter, a copy, and bureaucrats. Usually heads of observatories loved using this kind of thing, but for historians, it's kind of hard to read. But it's nice to have this record, because with combining Huggins' letters to Gill, which he kept in chronological order with his outgoing letters, we have basically both sides of the conversation. This is a rarity in the Huggins correspondence. Unfortunately, we don't have the received correspondence of William Huggins. What happened to it is a major mystery. It may have been destroyed in some way, or is just gone missing. But the only times we have the back and forth letters are when one of his correspondents kept copies. Later, Hale would start using a typist to type out his and use carbon paper. So there's another example of times when we have back and forths, which is just totally the most amazing thing, to be able to see both sides of the conversation, listen in on them. The detailed instructions, cautions, clarifications, and corrections that these letters contain give voice to the tacit knowledge missing in published accounts that had to be transferred in order to conduct this collaborative and very delicate work. Sadly, despite the images captured by Gill and Woods that seemed to show the solar corona, the ever-cautious Gill was not yet prepared to say he was quite sure about success. He was a Scotsman, after all. His lack of certainty plagued Huggins. Their letters bring to light the anxiety and frustration experienced by both men as their hopes for success began to fade. By late fall of 1885, Huggins despaired of gaining the kind of absolute proof that he needed. The excitement and enthusiasm that he had felt earlier in that year turned to exasperation by the beginning of 1886. He complained to Stokes about the rough ways of most professional and amateur photographers. The reputations of astronomers are at stake, he noted, and dependent on the skill or lack thereof of artisans, who have an obvious incapacity even to understand properly the conditions of the method. Happily, another total eclipse was due in August. This one would last for 4 minutes and make landfall on the tiny Caribbean island of Grenada. Huggins hoped that eclipse observers would be able to photograph the moon in silhouette against the background of the backdrop of the corona before and after totality. He also hoped that they would be able to confirm the presence of coronal streamers in the direction of Mercury and Venus, evidence that he believed would support his developing electrical theory of the corona. Gill, for his part, urged Huggins, please, 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 this is not the first time he's asked Huggins to do this, but he, you know, please come to the Cape and help photograph the moon on the corona during the partial eclipse that would be seen from that location. You know, let me just go back. You notice that it crosses in Angola, the area that was, the city was Benguela, and the Brits didn't send an expedition to that location because they had weather predictions that said that it was just too likely to be cloudy. It was not worth the expense. But Gill down at the Cape, which isn't shown on the at the bottom of the map, was able to capture images of the partial eclipse that he observed there. Weather in Grenada was somewhat temperamental, and the corona did not present a particularly pronounced appearance. And news from the Cape was also disappointing. Disheartened, Huggins confided to Stokes, "I am doubtful now as to how I should look at the early favorable results." He longed to be able to show Stokes again one of the very early trials, the one which made me feel pretty certain about the matter, and the one which, when Abney saw, he exclaimed, "It is the corona." Unfortunately, Huggins lamented, that particular photograph had deteriorated with time, adding, "I have never since got any photo showing distinct forms in the same manner." Now, in strictest confidence, Huggins finally voiced some concern about the quality of the riffle photographs, and he carefully began distancing himself from them. After another shipment of photographs arrived from the Cape, Huggins proclaimed his profound exasperation to Stokes. "I think the truth of the matter is summed up in what I said to my wife, that all the photos are spoilt through bad photography." This, of course, in confidence, but it would be well to point out to Gill, if you should write to him, as Gill himself has no knowledge of photography, that the photographs for the corona need much greater delicacy of treatment. It is badly damaging to the method to send photographs which show so little intelligence in their production. His strong words indicate more about his state of mind than Gill's photographic abilities. Huggins exhibited even greater impatience and disappointment the following summer. Photographs from the Cape showed nothing, or next to nothing, which can be supposed to be coronal, and he concluded that they had been processed incorrectly. He ceased to have any confidence in further efforts at the Cape and instead renewed his own trials. Now, the question naturally arises, and I'm sure you're thinking this yourself, whether any of these photographs still exist. I mean, plates and plates and plates were taken. Over the years, I have made numerous attempts to locate surviving plates or prints, but without success. Fortunately, the close attention to detail that was required while annotating my transcriptions of Huggins's correspondence for publication brought into relief a slender but common thread that I had overlooked while concentrating on larger issues. This slender thread, a recurring reference to April 24, 1888, appears in Huggins's correspondence between February 1889 and June of 1892. In these letters, we learn of photographs Huggins had taken of the uneclipsed sun in the spring of 1888. After examining several of these photographs, George Stokes announced that one in particular, taken on April 24th, did indeed show the solar corona. Stokes' assessment encouraged Huggins to send a print of the photograph to E.S. Holden at the Washburn, David Gill, and Charles Young in Princeton, with the urgent request that they examine it carefully and voice their own candid opinion on what the image represents. He also sent, you see, there's a version called the pseudo-corona. He's still thinking about Pickering. He wanted to have let them see what a bad photograph that would be purporting to be the corona but would be actually a false image, what it might look like, in order for them to make a comparison with the one that Stokes believed showed the true corona. The successful location of Young's copy of this print at Dartmouth just last year offers hope that others may yet be found. So when you're in an archive, look this up. See, I did inquire at the Lick Observatory archives, and they were unable to find any such image. So they may not exist, but we can keep our fingers crossed. While continuing to pursue his own efforts, Huggins found that American astronomer George Ellery Hale, seen in that red circle up there, in 1898. So this is he's a little older than he's when I'm talking about him now. But George Ellery Hale was similarly driven to find a way to take routine photographs of the corona without an eclipse. That shared quest was a frequent topic of their lively correspondence. It is significant, I think, that Huggins never viewed Hale's creative efforts in this area as an intrusion on his own research territory. He uncharacteristically set aside his own ambitions and to keep Hale supplied with encouragement and advice on how to claim the elusive prize. In February 1893, before Hale's first attempt to photograph the corona at his Kenwood Observatory, oh, and actually I think I need to advance one more. This is from an article that Hale wrote outlining his different attempts. So here's the Kenwood Observatory in Chicago, and that was where he did where Hale conducted his first attempts. And you see that Huggins is writing to him very enthusiastically, "I hope you may succeed. I have little doubt that it is to be done." Unfortunately, it did not succeed, and after failure forced Hale to acknowledge both the hopelessness of coronal photography beneath a Chicago sky and shortcomings of his apparatus, he planned an expedition to Pike's Peak in Colorado. When word of Hale's intentions reached Huggins, he wrote at once, both to share words of wisdom based on his own years of wrestling with a challenge and to persuade Hale to try also my original simple plan. The apparatus is easily put together. 2 days later, he sent more suggestions, concluding cheerfully, "I do hope you will succeed. I should be much interested to have my simple plan," hint, hint, "tried by such skillful hands as yours, at a good observatory, and at a time when the corona is favorable." Unfortunately, Pike's Peak proved a bit inhospitable. Dust blew onto and scratched the mirror's surface. Low air pressure hampered the operation of the clepsydra that moved the instrument's slits during exposures, and insects swarmed across their view of the sun, and smoke and haze from frequent forest fires made photographing the corona a futile effort. "I am so grieved that you have not succeeded with the corona," Huggins wrote to console Hale after hearing of the failure. "I thought you would at least be able to make a step in advance." In July of 1894, the very next year after the Pike's Peak expedition, Hale spent a week on Mount Etna, battling both the corona and the great volcano. Sulfurous fumes tarnished the mirror. When smoke from the crater was not covering the sun, bright halos surrounded it, and, as on Pike's Peaks, large swarms of insects interfered with the view. Insects play a big role in this. The failure on Mount Etna prompted Huggins to write, "I am so sorry that you do not come crowned with the corona. I hope the failure was due to some accident of bad weather and not clearly to the method itself." But Hale conceded that the method was at least partly to blame. He devised yet another ingenious method for separating out the faint coronal light, this time using a bolometer to register what he believed would be its measurable amounts of heat radiation. Ultimately, the corona eluded its would-be captors until an as yet unborn French solar observer, he was born in 1897, Bernard Leo, met with success in 1930. It's worth noting that in both his original paper and his address to the RAS in 1939 upon receiving the Society's gold medal, Leo began with a brief history of previous attempts to photograph the solar corona without an eclipse. He referred to efforts by Samuel Pierpont Langley in 1878, Henri-Alexandre Deslandres in 1893, and to those of Hale and Annibale Rico on Mount Etna in 1894. But he made no mention of Huggins. Today, Leo, not Huggins, is credited with developing the coronagraph, which made it possible for solar observers to study the corona at all times. Leo could have done a bit more thorough literature review. But we should not judge him too harshly for overlooking Huggins's contributions. By omitting from the New Astronomy all references to his years-long battle with the corona, Huggins seems to have successfully erased his name from the collective memory of those who would chronicle the history of solar physics. Fortunately, his private correspondence allows us to restore the details of his work on this project to the public record. His letters reveal that failure did not stifle his research efforts. Rather, it motivated him at every turn to improve his methods and instrumentation, and it forced him to hone his rhetorical and technical skills in order to persuade others of the soundness of his plan. His continuing struggle to convince others of the validity of his coronal photographs renders visible the means by which a scientific community achieves consensus on what counts as conclusive evidence. And in an important way, his confidence that the outer atmosphere of the sun could be studied daily helped shape the methods of solar observation that were developed, the types of questions being asked about the solar atmosphere, and the direction in which solar research was undertaken by his successors at the turn of the century. This, by the way, is a beautiful stained glass window, which you're close enough to it. You can take a drive out to Wellesley College and see it in person. This is a stained glass window that was designed by the Hugginses and was in their home. And after his death, Margaret sent this and two other stained glass windows that they had in their house to Wellesley to inspire the students, and as well as the notebooks. But thank you very much.
Thank you very much for excavating this extraordinary effort from its anonymity and silence. So I put the floor open for comments or questions. Ava.
What do you think about William Pickering's effort and argument and his opinion of what Huggins had done?
Well, you know, no one has tried. I think it would be very difficult to even attempt to replicate what they did. And because the kinds of photography, the films that are used nowadays are so different, you'd have to be a historian of photography. What I'm really hoping is that someone with some knowledge of that kind of thing would be able to examine the originals at Dartmouth and see what they can detect. And of course, the other thing is that, you know, years ago, I was always curious as to Galileo, when he wrote The Sidereal Messenger, he had these little drawings of the moons of Jupiter, and I thought, you know, it's really easy to do. You just put little dots next. You know, how accurate are these positions? No one else. I mean, he was the only one to see it at that moment, right? And so then I got out of a planetarium, one of those old software things, and I put in the dates, and there they were. They were exactly in the... But you can't do that with the sun. I mean, there's no way to replicate what the sun might have looked at like on a particular day. So even knowing the date on which a photograph was taken of this of the solar corona, you'd have no way of knowing. So there perhaps might be some way that an expert photographer, historian of photography, might be able to examine this print and detect what effects might have caused. There were lots of explanations for what was seen. Halation, this sort of glow, this light scattering on off the plates and so on. But no one, it was anybody's guess. The Huggins's complaint was that about Pickering's efforts were that he was not using Huggins's method properly. He had set up his apparatus incorrectly, and no doubt you're going to have different kinds of pictures because you're going to have false effects from the way your stuff is set up. And that was one of the reasons why he really, really, really wanted Hale to use his particular method so that he could see how it was working in somebody he trusted. He'd lost confidence in the Cape photography. So he
he really literally loved Hale, and it's actually quite a remarkable, if you have a chance to read through some of their letters, it's just obvious that the two men shared a very uncommon bond, and for Huggins, and you can see in his comments, his very snide remarks to people, never an unkind word about Hale, never ever, and to share that search, be willing to give up that search and hand the baton over to this young strapping guy. You know, it was kind of an amazing, amazing thing. So, but
did I understand correctly that the one photograph that he had that had seemed convincing was one that was actually taken by him?
Yes.
In London?
Yes, that's correct.
Why didn't he just continue his efforts
he did.
There?
He did. He did, but the problem was London was a really crappy place to try taking pictures of an unclouded sky. That picture, the one that we have the print of, was taken in London. But just the days were so few and far between. And I think what he realized was that he either needed to be able to take a photograph in London while an eclipse was going on someplace else, so that both of them are looking at the same sun at the same time, right? Or the other thing would be to have a whole range of photographs taken that's what he had Gill doing, was take it at 10 o'clock, at 11 o'clock, at 12 o'clock, at 2 o'clock, keep taking it constantly all day long. You just couldn't do that in London. It was just, the weather was just too unpredictable.
Still, it seems that if he had succeeded over a period of 20 mm-hmm. years to have 5 or 6 mm-hmm. plates that
yeah,
showed that,
yeah, yeah.
that would have been something of a success.
Well, you have to. The one thing about Huggins that is different from a number of his colleagues, and he was a silk merchant, right? So he was in business as a silk merchant until he was 30 years old. His background, he didn't have an academic degree or preparation that prepared him to work on a project in a focused, straightforward way. He was eclectic. He dabbled in love. It's part of his key to success, actually, was that he was always looking for a niche, an unoccupied niche. And he failed lots of times. He came up with a whole apparatus in which he was going to measure the heat of stars. That didn't work out. You know, so there were all these different projects that he worked on that didn't have much chance of success. But that didn't stop him from trying. He did try. But he had his fingers in lots of pots, and he was more interested, I think, in nighttime stellar observation, nebular observation. His daytime solar corona stuff, he probably slept during the day, you know, required that he stay up 24 hours if he was going to do his nighttime stuff. But that, I mean, I think that's a good question as to why he didn't, but I don't think I just don't think he saw solar observation as being his major contribution. He just would have been happy to see a little bit more signs of success. And I think there were these little teasing bits that seemed successful and kept him going, but ultimately...
The way you worded your question mm-hmm. seems to suggest that if he'd only tried harder, he would have been able to get it from sea level, essentially. And the success with the coronagraph is, of course, entirely by using high altitude sights. Mm-hmm. And I think he was looking after a will-o'-the-wisp that wasn't
but
going
the
to
riffle,
be possible.
The riffle photographs, you wonder if Mount Krakatoa had just waited a couple years.
Yeah, well that's getting
you know,
up
it was just that was bad luck.
Somewhat.
Yeah.
Why don't you move over here?
Oh, okay.
Because then you're more easily photographed
oh.
for the great audience who has been watching you
oh my
on
goodness.
Their television
okay.
sets. All right. Yes.
I think you may have answered this, but was Huggins continuing his nighttime spectroscopic research all
yes.
the time this was going on?
Oh sure. Yeah. There were different novas that occurred that he observed and yeah, he was
Yeah. So does that explain why he wouldn't go to South Africa? Wasn't he his number one?
I don't know why he wouldn't go to South Africa. He never came to the United States either. He was invited to be the keynote speaker at the opening of the Yerkes Observatory. Hale invited him. He really wanted Huggins to come. He felt it was significant because Hale really perceived him as the father of astrophysics. And felt that his own career was kind of, you know, this continuation of what Huggins had started. And he originally agreed to come, but in the end he decided, he was quite old by that time. He was born in 1824, and the Yerkes was 1898, 1897, something like that. So it was, and then of course there was this big delay that in the construction, so they had to be put off even longer. But he declined to travel to the United States because it was just too difficult. And I think it may have been really more just an unwillingness. He did travel to Europe, but it's not like he just stayed in London all the time. But a trip to the Cape seemed a bit much for him.
Yeah. So when Huggins and Hale and all these people were struggling to see this corona during the day and everything, did they in their discussion, I mean, they knew about sunspots and the solar
yes.
cycle, presumably,
right.
and everything. Did they consider that when they were photographing the corona, saying that sometimes the sun might not really be good because it's more quiet now?
Yes.
Did they consider the solar cycle in their
the
work?
The connection was beginning to start to fall into place between the I mean, they did notice, Norman Lockyer participated in lots of solar eclipses, and he was certainly aware that there were times when the corona was quieter and times when it was really quite extravagant. And the connection, though, in the solar activity, this was something that Hale was going to really develop after Huggins' death, wanted to find solutions to these. And why do these things happen? What's the connection between them? But yeah, they were aware of that. And actually, in that one letter that Huggins wrote, he wanted Hale to go to Pikes Peak that year because the corona should be in good form. So he wanted it to be have the optimum chance for something to show up.
What were some of the contributions of his wife to the research?
Well. They married in 1875. Huggins was in his 50s. She was 28, I think, 27. She contributed, first of all, the photography. I think Huggins began to realize about that time that, nowadays it's kind of hard to put ourselves back mentally into that time when astronomical photography was in a sort of a no man's land in a way. No one really was sure whether what they were photographing really was as good as what people could see with their eyes. But by 1875, they had started to develop dry plates that you didn't have to snap a thing while the collodion was rapidly drying. So he knew that if he was going to stay on the cutting edge, he was going to have to start using photography, incorporating it into his work. But he didn't have that, I guess, as a background. He didn't really use photography until after they were married. And after they were married in 1875, she started taking over the notebook records. And one of the very first things that she writes about is testing the dry plates against the collodion plates, and she was really in charge of that. But what you see, her role only kind of came to the surface over a long period of time, looking at a lot of different things. She was very artistic and illustrated many of his articles after they were married. And there was one point where I'm convinced that he started really seeing how valuable she was. And that was in work done in the late 1880s on the Orion Nebula spectrum. They were working really hard And they had to share the work. If you've ever looked at a sparkler with unprotected eyes, you know how brilliant it is. And if you've ever seen a faint spectrum of a nebula, you know how faint that is. And the contrast in those observations was very, very taxing. They got involved in a major controversy with Norman Lockyer about their work. And to put all these matters to rest, they were going to do this, you know, final picture, and it was going to prove that they were right all along and Lockyer was wrong. They got to a point where the Orion Nebula was moving out of the sky. It was getting to be March, and Orion was not going to be accessible anymore, and they had taken this one photograph. She discovered that their apparatus was slightly out of alignment with the spectrum, and I don't know whether it was her idea or William's, but when they went to write the article, they described this misalignment as being purposeful. That they had purposefully tried to give Norman Lockyer every possible advantage by moving it in this direction. But still, you can see that the lines don't line up and so on. But it was after that, and actually that was the first paper where Margaret appears as co-author. In 1880. They'd been married for 14, 15 years already, been working together all this time, but it was after that Orion paper that they always appeared as co-authors. And I think he put such store by his methodical, you know, very great care that he used with his apparatus and so on, that if he had published this without making, you know, pointing out this error in some positive way, poor Huggins would have been really thrashed by Lockyer on that.
I'm curious about the chronographs of that time, because has anybody who has a knowledge of modern techniques had a chance to look at either detailed drawings or maybe instruments that were, I don't know if any of Hale's equipment survived, for example, but it ought to be possible to figure out whether or not this equipment, even under good conditions at a high site, would have been even capable of seeing the corona, just based on physical arguments. And that might be interesting to do.
Yeah, it would be. The drawings of the different instruments exist. Now, the coronagraph that I showed the photograph of that was at the Cape, I think that actually physically still exists. I think it's still at the Cape. That photograph is from the turn of the century, I think. It might have been. They used it to observe something else. I can't remember now. But I think that instrument still actually exists. It would be interesting to talk to Ian Glass and find out more about the drawings that accompany that. The little sketch that was drawn by Grubb for his instrument, that's all we really have to go on for the other stuff. What I'm hoping to do here, folks, okay, I'm giving you all science fair projects, but it would be, I mean, that's one of the things is that we, you know, we weren't there then. We didn't see the stuff, but I think that there is enough information in the permanent record that someone with expertise in analyzing these instruments, these photographs, and so on, should be able to make some kind of assessment of them. I mean, maybe that photograph that exists at Dartmouth shows just, you know, it may just be an artifact, may not be a corona at all.
Well, just one follow-up. Leo may have discussed what he, the advances that he made in his work and the previous shortcomings of other attempts in his paper. I never have read that literature, but there might be something in there because it might be worth looking at.
He started thinking that relying on photographic film to capture just an isolated narrow range of the spectrum might not have been as effective as that filtering process. He tried to go back to that, but he couldn't find a source for the violet glass that he had used in the past. So the problem was that some of these chemical solutions changed chemically and created little particles in them when sunlight hit them. Big problem. He experimented with a disc in to block out the sun. He experimented by cutting a hole in the film so that the sun, wherever the sun was going to land, that wouldn't there would be no image that would just capture the corona. He tried black velvet material, and he tried all sorts of things. Found them to be varyingly effective. But if you don't have a sense that you're going in a direction, it's hard to know. But he was a gimmick person. He liked gizmos. He liked there's one right there.
Josh,
quick question. Yeah. His Doppler shift experiment on Sirius.
Yes.
Was visual or photographic?
Yes. Yes.
I thought you said it was
yes. Visual. Totally visual.
Did he ever? And what did he claim for a velocity?
Oh, he was really wrong. I forget now. I have it written down in the book, but it's whichever direction is really going in, he had it going in the other way by quite a bit. But the thing, I mean, can you imagine setting up your chemical apparatus to have your spark going on? I forget now what he used. He used hydrogen, I think. And then looking through your telescope at the spectrum of the star and trying to eyeball whether and in his notebook, this I thought this was really interesting, that if you look at his note, he does have notebook entries for his observations of the Doppler, his very first Doppler efforts, and there are sometimes when he sees it being less refrangible, sometimes more refrangible than his laboratory spectrum, so he waffles back and forth, and he doesn't enter into the notebook enough data points to let you know as a reader why did he suddenly decide, okay, this side wins and by how much. But I think it's absolutely astonishing. The thing, so you could say, all right, so Huggins didn't really invent the Doppler redshift method. He was obviously way wrong. But the thing that he did do, and this goes back to his salesmanship experience, is that he sold that sucker. He told people that this could be done and that it would be of great value to positional astronomers. They were the hardest core group in the traditional astronomy group to really pull into his, you know, through that door. Because what difference did it make to a positional astronomer what a star was made out of? Nothing. But when you had a radial velocity, you didn't have a two-dimensional sky anymore. You had you could figure out where things were headed and what the shape of things in 3D.
Did he write this up? Was this?
Yes, he did.
It was a paper.
Oh yes.
And he never showed any interest in doing it photographically later on when it became possible.
No, and I'll tell you why. Because he knew that his equipment that he had was not stable enough. It didn't actually get done photographically until Fogel, and Fogel actually was constructed a telescope, and his equipment was like rock solid. It wasn't going to vibrate or move. I mean, the little shifts that were involved, you had to have something that you could count on being steady and reliable, and his equipment at home was just not up to that standard. So he did not pursue that. He had other fish to fry. He had other more interesting things to conquer.
We'll take one more question. Alan, you still?
Yeah, I just wanted to confirm that in the photos you showed us, there was no occulting disc that was used in his device.
Oh, in the coronagraph?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think he did. He'd used this little, one of the diagrams it mentions a little tiny brass disc that was used, a 50th of an inch, or I don't know.
I was wondering why the solar disc was so dark.
So, yeah, right.
Okay, so
right.
It was
cosmical. Yeah, right, right.
Well, let's thank Barbara again for